Remember, friends, a lot of these basic findings in statistics came from a very, very interesting source, that was agriculture. So you see, we are looking at applications, and that is why I have put a slide on for you, which shows you, you know, how in agriculture different plots of land were experimented with. So you could have nice experimental designs with fertilizer used there, not used here, or a certain kind of seed used in plot A, plot B, plot C, and all these kinds of variations experimentally designed in order to understand where does the statistical significance really come in. You will be interested to know that so much of these methodologies came from agriculture, came from breweries, came from all these areas where applied knowledge was important. Having understood this much, let us look at the very important concept of region of rejection on the normal curve. Usually, a researcher has to take a decision in terms of whether they want to choose a one-tailed or a two-tailed test for their data analysis. What does this really mean? A careful look at the slide will show you that on the normal curve, one has to decide a specific area, which is your region of rejection. Now, this will depend upon the alpha value that you have chosen. If, for example, as we took instances earlier, one has looked at the possibility of chance error being 0.05, then that is your region for rejection, which means you are ready to take a 5% chance. If your region for rejection is more stringent, that is 0.01, then you just want a 1 out of 100 chance that this may be a chance finding. You just want to accept that much possibility. Now, as you will see on the slide, this region for rejection can all lie at one end of the distribution. That means it is a one-tailed kind of analysis where you are saying that I believe that my mean 1 will be higher than mean 2, and that is what I am going to test in my hypothesis. If, however, I use a two-tailed hypothesis, which means that I divide up that region for rejection. So, instead of taking all 0.05 on one side, I will take 0.025 one side, 0.025 on the other side, then I will have a two-tailed test. And then I can actually go ahead with a null hypothesis and say that to start with, I think there is no difference between my two means. I really do not know, based on my literature review, based on past research, which of the two means is likely to be higher than which of the other means. So it's very important, for example, a simple test, less simple statistical analysis like a t-test, it's very important while looking up the table whether you're looking up a one-tailed value or a two-tailed value of the t-test, and that's really what this slide is trying to show you. The reason I also reiterated this particular point was that very often many of us use software to do statistical analysis, data analysis, and the software requires you to specify where your regions of rejection lie. It should not be left to chance. So otherwise you will not understand the meaning of your own data. So always make a very wise choice in terms of where you want your region of rejection to lie. Importantly, again, at this stage is the importance of sampling. One has read a lot of material on sampling, and looking at sampling methods is not really the gist of today's session. But it is very important that we sample well, because if we do not, then we are going to draw wrong conclusions, because we will have a very biased kind of sample that we have in our distribution. If we are looking at a very stringent experimental design where we are carefully sampling, we are using stratified sampling, ideally we are using systematic random sampling, which is actually the gold standard. It is really very difficult to do random sampling. So then and only then will we have what we call a true experimental design. The reason it is called a gold standard is because it's an ideal. It's because the conclusions that you draw from such a design are really very, very reliable. But sometimes it is not practicable to do this. There are so many constraints that we have. Some are ethical constraints, some are constraints of procedure. We do not have the freedom to really do the sampling that we want to do. We might want to look at incidental samples, availability samples, convenience samples. So then we go into what we call quasi-experimental designs. It is not as if quasi-experimental designs are not good enough, but they are certainly not as stringent as experimental designs, and many of us in the social sciences fall back on quasi-experimental designs in order to conduct our research. Quasi-experimental designs give us a little more flexibility. They allow us to sample in different ways, like all those examples I gave you. Sometimes we might even go into a like a snowball sample, allow some of our subjects to collect more subjects for us, and so on. Quasi-experimental designs can also give us things like time series, give us the freedom to measure our subjects again and again and look at what sort of changes have taken place. These kind of designs can also work with less or more number of subjects. The important thing is that when you're choosing your data analysis, we do have to check whether it's meeting all the constraints that we require for a parametric data analysis, and if not, we have to choose non-parametric data analysis. So now we are going to next look at these two conceptions and really try to understand what are the differences between them. So let us do a quick revision of some of these very crucial concepts that we just looked at. One concept was the concept of statistics and parameters. So we understood that the population parameter is out there and we may not always be able to measure it entirely. Let's take a quick example. For example, if I'm looking at the entire population of India as my population parameter, I cannot possibly measure it in any way, any variable for that entire number. So then I have to derive a sample statistic and I have to be able to gauge what sort of measures I'm likely to come up with in the population based on the sample statistic. In contrast, sometimes one has easy access to the entire population. For example, if I'm looking at all the school principals of say one particular stream of schools in the city of Mumbai, that's a large sample, but nevertheless my entire population can be reached. I can practically access all these people. Hence, one has to take a decision what sort of sampling to do, but we did look at how important this kind of careful sampling is so that we do not land up with sample biases that will spoil our data analysis. So we looked at, for example, a sample mean and a population parameter of mu, for which we have a specific confidence interval with which one can draw this conclusion. So these were some concepts we looked at. We also looked at how it is important to choose the kind of statistics that we are going to use, the kind of region for rejection that we are going to choose, and how we really arrived at all these decisions. Based on this, we said we can have parametric analysis, parametric statistics, and non-parametric statistics. Usually, you will find that studies would prefer to use parametric statistics. The reason for this is we are looking at better and more robust kind of conclusions. But for parametric statistics, one does need to know that my population is normally distributed. I need to know that my sampling is correctly done. I usually have to have interval scales at least. I understand that in social science research, it is quite difficult to go to ratio scales, but ordinal interval scales can often be used. Can we use ordinal scales for parametric statistics? Very rarely. Hence, for parametric statistics, one must meet all these different criteria. And if, in contrast, I find that my samples are very small, my distribution is a little skewed or kurtotic, that perhaps sampling that I have is not very, very scientific, okay, I'm not able to do a random sample or even a systematic or a stratified kind of sample. If I'm looking more at incidental samples, then I might prefer to choose a non-parametric choice of statistical analysis, of data analysis. So then why is it that we don't use that so often? Because it seems to be quite flexible. One seems to have a lot of freedom beyond normality, etc. The reason we do not choose non-parametric as often or by preference is because these statistical methods are not really always as robust. Sometimes to draw conclusions based on them is more difficult. Parametric statistics does give us more robust conclusions, but as we said, we require interval data and we require all those assumptions to be satisfied of normality and so on. Now, based on this, we are going to go actually further and look at what sort of further data analysis decisions we are going to make. One data analysis decision that we have to take when you are choosing your statistics is, am I really going to make a comparison between two groups or am I really looking at relationships? So obviously, and all of us know this, we are going to have to choose different statistical procedures in both instances. Let us look at comparisons first. When I'm trying to compare mean 1 with mean 2 or group 1 with group 2 in a standard experimental or quasi-experimental design. Now for this, in many of the statistical softwares that we use, we get an option that is called GLM, a generalized linear model. Now these are the options that are available to us when we are comparing two groups. All sorts of statistical analysis can come under this generalized linear model. But over here, again, to reiterate, one does have to check that the distribution is normal, that you have at least interval data, and that there is homogeneity of variance. So it's important to use statistical procedures and check for all these things. And of course, your sampling needs to be unbiased throughout. Having gone into this generalized linear model, and remember, we are talking about comparisons here, not correlations, not study of relationships, although we are going to come to them soon. What are the various sort of comparisons that are available to us? Oh, there are many. When one is studying differences, that means trying to compare two groups or three groups, how the means of these groups are different from one another, and we've already looked at all the assumptions before. Let us look at this slide and understand what are various data analysis options that we have. Let us start with a very simple t-test, where you look at comparisons between two groups. Here what we are trying to do is we are trying to compare mean 1 versus mean 2. So obviously we are looking at both the standard deviations. We are trying to see whether this difference between these two means is statistically significant. And as you know, there can be a variety of t-tests. There can be t-tests where the same group is yielding two different sets of data, or there can be independent t-tests of two different independent groups which we are comparing with each other. Other than that, we also have the option of analysis of variance. Here now we have an omnibus hypothesis. So remember what we said earlier about the error rates that we accept, like a 0.05 or a 0.01. Now what would happen, for example, if I'm comparing three different groups, group A, B and C, if I were to restrict myself to t-tests, I would have to first compare groups A and B with a t-test, then B and C with a t-test, and then with A and C with a t-test. So actually, even if I'm saying my alpha region is 0.05, I'm actually building up to 15% because I'm accepting that error every time. So what do I do instead? I choose to do an analysis of variance where I'm comparing all the three groups in one shot. That is why it's called an omnibus hypothesis. So I do not build up on my error. Then what I can do is, if my analysis of variance findings are significant, I can choose to do post hoc t-tests. Again, many softwares offer you a variety of post hoc t-tests. You have to look at your assumptions and your nature of your data and decide which one to use. So you can have analysis of variance of various sorts. Again, look at your slide. You will find a normal regular analysis of variance that we have randomized with various groups being compared. One can have a repeated measures analysis of variance where the same data, same sample is being tested again to generate more data. One can also have an analysis of covariance. This is a very interesting data analysis method where what we can do is we can co-vary out a particular variable which you feel is not of interest to you but which may actually be vitiating some of your findings. Let's take a simple example. Suppose I'm comparing a certain test or a certain activity which I'm giving to three different age groups. Let us say I'm looking at people between 20 and 30 years, 30 and 40 years, and 40 and 50 years. I'm going to measure things like reaction time, speed with which they can complete the task, the errors they make. The ANCOVA, or analysis of covariance, is indeed a very interesting method of data analysis. What you actually do here is you covary out a particular variable, which you have to measure, of course, in the first instance, when you feel that it is going to interfere or vitiate your findings of your actual ANOVA. Let's take a simple example. Suppose I'm going to take three different age groups. Let us say 20 to 30 years, 30 to 40 years, and 40 to 50 years. And I'm going to actually compare how they perform in terms of various different In an analysis of covariance, what we call the ANCOVA, what we actually do is very interesting in this method of data analysis. We have here a variable that we don't really want as part of our analysis. We feel it in fact might vitiate our findings in some way. So what do? We actually covary out that variable. Let us take an example. Suppose I'm looking at a comparison of say three different groups or two different groups, three groups let us say for the sake of our example, where I'm comparing their performance on a certain task. So I'm going to count how long they take to complete that task, how many errors they make, what sort of reaction time they have and so on. Right? Now obviously all these people are going to be of different ages. So some of them may actually belong to an older age group, some may belong to a younger age group, and I feel that that age group itself might actually make for faster and slower responses. So what do I plan to do? In the ANCOVA, so what we do is, in the analysis of covariance, we partial out the factor of age. Now here you see why it is important to plan your data analysis well before. Because if you hadn't taken the ages of your participants, you cannot do this procedure. So what you will now do is, in the analysis of covariance, you will partial out the age. So what you will get is your mean variable and the mean effect of this variable on the performance of these subjects. So ANCOVA is one option. Other than that, as we have already mentioned, we can also have post hoc t-tests for all these options, and one can have two ways, three ways ANOVAs in order to take at a time various omnibus hypotheses on board. Now let us look at not differences but relationships. What sort of analysis do we do when we want to look at relationships between groups? Usually the statistics that we choose is correlation, or we might choose regression. What is the difference? In correlations, we are merely seeing how data varies. Whether when one set of data goes up, does the other rise with it? Or is it like an inverse relationship? As one goes up, the second goes down. What we just saw was an example of an inverse relationship. As age goes up, speed may go down of performance, motor speed, and so on. So in this kind of relationship, you have a variety of options of even correlations. You can go for a Pearson correlation if you have interval data. You can go to a Spearman if you want to do rank order. Remember what we said in the beginning of our discussion? Sometimes we just have ordinal data, we do not have interval data, so we fall back on a Spearman rank order correlation. Very interestingly, there are so many other correlations available. There are curvilinear relationships, you can have logistic regressions, you can also look at in the correlations, you can have special correlations. Sometimes it's possible that your data is just divided into two, it is just split. Alright, so one can have the option of something like a phi correlation, a biserial or a point biserial correlation. So there are many, many available options. All these options are available to us in softwares also. And believe me, it's very easy to do them manually. It is really not difficult to carry out any of these correlational analyses manually, provided your data is not very, very large. When you're looking at regressions, what are you trying to do? You're trying to predict one variable from the other. So again, these may be linear in nature. So it's a linear relationship between these two variables or not. When we do regression analysis, what we are trying to do is predict one variable from the other variable, or sometimes predict multiple variables from each other. Again, there are many options. One can have multiple regressions, one can have stepwise regressions. All these options are available to one in various softwares. And again, like I said earlier, one can do them manually. One must just understand the nature of the data. Is it linear at all, or is there a curvilinear relationship? So always test your data, plot it, see your scatter plot, and then decide whether you want to do a specific kind of correlation or regression. Once again, we will have to test these correlations and regressions for statistical significance. So that is an important part of our data analysis procedure. So let us take a quick look back at what exactly we looked at today. We decided that data analysis is a very important and actually a very exciting part of our data, of our research process. In that, we looked at how we first use descriptives, then how we use all sorts of conclusions, how we actually draw conclusions based on our data, so what we call inferential statistics. Then we moved finally to looking at parametric and non-parametric analysis. What are the options available to us and why we choose a particular option over the other? We also looked at when we are studying differences, what sort of analysis to go for, and one when one is studying relationships, what sort of analysis to go for. In this process, we kept reiterating the importance of sampling and how one has to be very rigorous when using specific sampling methodologies. Finally, right now, we also looked at how we can predict data points, and look at what sort of a prediction equation is coming up in the regression. In the process, we also talked about hypothesis testing. We talked of confidence intervals. So we actually said how sure are we about the conclusions we have drawn, and also how we are going to distribute our region of rejection while choosing either null or directional hypotheses. Finally, what I'm going to do for you is I'm going to display a large array of statistical methods. I know it's a very busy slide. I'm going to leave it on for you to have a proper look at for a long time, because these are the various options. Think of it as a buffet. Think of it as a choice that you have to make, but it's a reasoned choice. It's not the kind of emotional choice you make in a buffet. So what you have to do is you have to look at the kind of scale you have, nominal ordinal interval ratio. You have to look at the kind of answers you want, the conclusions that you want to draw, whether your distribution is normal or non-normal, and accordingly you can choose either a parametric or a non-parametric statistics. So I'm not going to discuss this last slide in great detail. You can have your own look at it. All these procedures are available in software as well as in various statistical textbooks. All I'm trying to say in that slide is you have options. So for example, if you want to compare two groups, you have a parametric option where you can do a t-test analysis, or you can use the non-parametric parallel of the same. When you have an analysis of variance, again you have a parametric option of the ANOVA, or one can go to a Kruskal-Wallis or a Friedman analysis. So each of these are available to us. Plus, there are very, very robust techniques like chi-squared, etc., which can actually be used even with ordinal data. So what I want to end on is this note that you are the master. When you are doing data analysis, you have to own your data. You have to understand your data. Let it speak to you. And then make a very reasoned decision of what sort of data analysis to choose. Very, very important, of course, is also deciding upon power, how much of power you have while drawing these conclusions. But those discussions will come later. We actually are looking at the basis of data analysis today, and that is, as I said, specifically quantitative analysis. So we shall end our session here today. Thank you very much.